Today, we're doing not one, but two seemingly impossible things at the same time. We're measuring the speed of an object while it stays constantly the same distance away from us. And we're measuring two independent things, distance and velocity, with only one sample of data. That's right, this is the buy one, get one free sale. Come for one magic trick, get the second one for free. Lucky for you, I'm not a magician, so I'll show you exactly how the trick is done. First, a quick recap from the last two videos. We have the same setup as before. Two mirrors that represent our laser, a target that the laser shoots at, and we're gonna draw the laser like a wave. On the right, we're gonna draw time and something we're gonna call the phase stimulus. This represents those fringes that we talked about in the last episodes. Every time the wave jumps, it has to realign itself so that it ends at a peak or a trough when it hits the target. As a result, the wave has to jump from peak to trough, and each time it does so, that is a fringe. And we'll call those fringes a input to the laser, a stimulus of the phase of the wave. As you can see here, with a constant velocity, the phase stimulus will happen at a constant rate, just like we learned in the velocity episode. Now, in reality, the photodiode is going to measure some offset, as we talked about in the last episode. It's not going to measure zero, it's going to measure some DC offset because the laser is on. And in addition to that, this phase stimulus is going to be quite small compared to the baseline power level. In other words, the reflection that's coming back is just not that strong. As a result, we're going to see a very tiny phase stimulus with mostly a flat laser power level. For the distance measurement, you'll remember that we're going to change the frequency of the laser by making the cavity slightly shorter and longer. And we're going to do this by varying the laser power. More power, bigger laser cavity, less power, smaller laser cavity. And that will change the wavelength of the laser. That change in the wavelength will cause fringes, which we can measure, and they will correlate with the distance to the target. So we see the same thing here. Now, this view is a little confusing, so I want to add a chart that more represents what we're actually going to look at. So what I've drawn here is a graph for demodulated and amplified power, basically subtracting out that DC offset and the modulation for the distance measurement. Also, I'm going to make the laser wavelength shorter to make it more realistic. We'll see more fringes that way, and it more represents an actual laser where there would be millions or frankly billions of these in a very short distance. Now let's do the same thing. Let's modulate the laser power down and then back up again, and we'll see the fringes come faster, but the same general pattern is there. Importantly, the fringes now stick out like a sore thumb, and it's not hard to measure them. So this is all great, but we haven't answered the question yet. How are we gonna measure both distance and velocity at the same time? Well, I'm going to animate what it's going to look like when we change the wavelength of the laser using the laser cavity and move the target at the same time. I want you to think about it for a second and try to picture in your head, what do you expect to happen? Think about what will happen to the wave. Think about what will happen to the fringes and what you expect to see in the final output. Okay, I'm gonna move the target closer and make the laser wavelength shorter. Let's see what happens. Wow. Almost no fringes at all. Why? You can go back and watch it again. It's very clear. As the wavelength of the laser gets shorter, the target moves closer to accommodate. So, the laser never needs to jump up or down. It just stays in phase with the target the whole time. Of course, this just happens to be the speed that I picked, but you can see the general principle. And even more interesting, what happens when the modulation of the laser flips and begins to increase the wavelength again? We now see twice as many fringes as we saw before. This is intuitively understandable. The wavelength now is getting longer, but the target is still getting closer. So of course the fringes are gonna come at us much, much quicker. If you really think about it, you can kind of imagine what will happen in the opposite case as well. Now the target's getting further away, but the wavelength is getting shorter, and then we flip, the wavelength gets longer as the target continues to get further away, and you see the same effect but the order is reversed. Now, I promised you that we would be able to measure the velocity and the distance with one sample. So how are we gonna do that? Well, we're gonna use the FFT just like we used before. Of course, the FFT is going to measure the frequency content of the signal. And the signal we're going to feed the FFT is this demodulated, amplified signal that we've been looking at on the lower right. We're gonna feed the signal into the FFT in order to get the frequency content of that signal. So what's it going to look like? As you can see here, we have two peaks. We have the zero frequency peak, or very close to it, and we have the peak further away from zero in the second section of the modulation. So basically what's happened is, by adding a velocity to the distance measurement, our single frequency peak that we used to have that was the same frequency going up and down now is two frequencies. They've split into a right and left side of the FFT. Effectively, one will always get larger, the other one will always get smaller. In fact, the average of the two will always correspond to the distance, and the difference between the two will always correspond to the velocity. So we end up with two frequencies that we can measure. The difference between them indicates velocity, and the average of them indicates the distance. With one FFT, we're able to measure both at the same time. The mathematical intuition here is that for both sections, the frequencies are either added or subtracted from each other. So the result looks like these two equations. We have a frequency for the first part of the modulation and a frequency for the second. Both terms have the frequency from distance and the frequency from velocity. So of course we can just rearrange these equations, and now we have an equation for distance frequency and an equation for velocity frequency. And just as we expected, one is subtracted and the other one is the average. Of course, there will be scale factors on these to convert them to real units like meters and miles per hour or whatever you want. But that's the easy part. If you're anything like me, you might be skeptical. Are these just the same thing being measured twice? Are they redundant information? Have we actually measured two different things? The first time I tried this, I was skeptical that I was actually measuring two completely independent quantities. After all, velocity is just the derivative of distance over time, right? And conversely, isn't distance just the integral of velocity? So won't the velocity we measure always just be a result of the distance and vice versa? Are we actually learning anything new? Is there new information that we're gaining? Or will distance and velocity always be coupled? In some cases, yes, they will be coupled. For example, if we mount a laser sensor on a stamping press, the velocity will be the derivative of the distance. This is true because the relative velocity is perfectly in line with the laser. But what if the laser is pointing on the side of the stamping press? The distance will be constant, so the velocity will be zero, right? Wrong. And the reason this is wrong comes down to scale. We are much too far away. We need to zoom in. Way in. No, like, way in. This is the relevant scale, because our laser has a wavelength measured in nanometers. So the roughness of the surface has an effect. And good thing too, because we were counting on that effect for our measurement to work. Let me show you what I mean. The key to remember is that our measurement is counting on the changes in the number of periods in our wave. That wave travels along the direction of the laser, which means we only measure velocities that are in line with the laser itself. At this scale, the surface roughness looks like mountains. Let's imagine our laser is mounted on an airplane and we're flying over mountains with the laser pointed straight down. As the mountains pass by, what velocity would we measure? The velocity is given by this vector that's drawn at the intersection where the laser hits the ground. The fact that the laser is getting closer or further away in distance from the plane doesn't make any difference. because the velocity vector is 90 degrees to the laser, it doesn't contribute to the velocity, and we will read a velocity of zero. Only the inline velocity with the laser will be measured. Now, if we change the angle of the laser and then we move, now we see that even though the velocity vector is the same as it was before and is across the screen horizontally, we now have a component of the laser that's in line with that velocity vector. So of course you can split this velocity vector into the inline component and the tangential component, and the inline component will be what we measure. You'll notice that the distance is going to change as we move across the rough surface. But for most surfaces we're measuring, like our metal stamping press, the surface roughness is in the microns range, so the corruption of our distance measurement is very small. If we're a meter away and we are a micron off, it's not that big a deal. In reality, we won't measure that because the spot size of our laser, how well we can focus that laser onto that spot, it won't be perfect. And we'll probably have like a millimeter or two diameter of the laser. And that will be much larger than any of the roughness. So in fact, we will end up taking an average of the peaks and valleys, and our distance will measure just fine. This gets a little complicated because we have reflections from each of the rough parts of the surface that all go in different directions and have slightly different phase stimulus for the laser. This starts to touch on a concept called laser speckle. We won't get into the details of that, but the main idea is that we can ignore speckle and we will, broadly speaking, average across the surface. By the way, I should note, we not only need to zoom in space, but we need to zoom in time. I've been drawing everything as happening very slowly over multiple seconds, but of course we want to measure very quickly, and that will solve a lot of other problems as well. So we're going to measure very fast, like tens of thousands of times per second. That way, if you get a weird sample here or there, you have thousands of other samples to choose from. As you can see, we haven't actually broken any laws of physics. The magic trick was about understanding the frequencies and how they add up and using scale to our advantage. Now, this is a very handy trick because think of everything we can use it for. For moving platforms like conveyor belts or assembly lines with products on them, you can detect the objects and the speed of the conveyor belt at the same time. You don't need two separate sensors to do it. If you mount this sensor on a vehicle, you can detect potholes or speed bumps in front of the wheels with no corruption of speed measurement. Conversely, the velocity of a moving vehicle can be measured. With a few combined lasers, you can measure it in all directions, X, Y, and Z, as well as the attitude of the ground, the pitch, the roll, and the height of the vehicle. In fact, this last application is what a SpeedBeam sensor does, and next time we'll talk about why this is the perfect technology for automotive applications.